Weekly Feed, Kyle Meredith. You might know this fellow over here, Les Claypool. How are you?
I am spectacular.
Yeah? That's good to hear.
Yeah.
I like checking on
things. Are good?
You got a lot going on.
I have a lot going on.
And maybe you always have a lot going on, but it seems like right now there is a bit more going on than usual because, and we're going to run through all of this, there is going to be a new Primus record that's very interesting. There's a book coming out. And of course, I've got you here in Louisville, Kentucky as a part of Duo de Twang.
Yes, twanging it up.
It's only a couple years old, this project, right?
That is correct.
Yeah, how did it come about? Because I guess I find it interesting. There was kind of an Americana explosion that happened a few years ago. And
I've been exploding Americana for 30 years.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't lump you into that, but it's a very interesting time for you to do this project.
We've been progressive Americana.
Progressive Americana?
Since the get-go.
Yeah. I don't think I've ever heard you kind of pitch.
Well, I mean, you know,
like
the lyrics of Jerry Was a Race Car Driver, you can't get much more Americana than that. Or one known as Big Brown Beaver.
That's true.
So or My Name Is Mud, a tweaker smashing his friend in the head with an aluminum baseball bat. Now, those are American values.
For the traditional Americana, though, and I guess we're, defining Americana loosely as a bit of an alt-country sound these days.
You put a banjo in there, they call it Americana.
Yeah, and that's a problem because I can look at like Jason Isbell as good Americana, and then I look at Mumford & Sons, and I'm not knocking anyone in this, but they don't seem like, I mean, they're not, I don't find it to be real, you know?
You know, if you looked at my iPod, which is jam-packed full of Americana that is, from the 30s and the 20s, and that's what I listen to. Yeah. My kids listen to Mumford & Sons, and I've heard some stuff, and it sounds good.
Yeah.
I don't dislike it.
It's hard to equate it to, like, Johnny Horton.
But I'm an old guy.
Yeah.
So Johnny Horton was, I grew up hearing Johnny Horton in the garage as I was, putting slicks on my purple American flyer.
Yeah. He's an interesting choice because he's one of those, I think you have to be in the know almost these days. Like growing up, maybe in your generation is different, but something is lost. I don't think Johnny Horton ever made. Johnny Horton was a guy that my dad always sang around to me. I knew those songs before I knew the originals,
Yeah, well, I mean, it's almost like how W.C. Fields and the Marx Brothers and Laurel and Hardy and whatnot sort of disappeared, and then there was this huge resurgence in the 70s. Mm-hmm. These artists, I think a lot of them will come back and be the iconic element will shine through, I would like to hope.
Yeah.
Because Johnny Horton was huge back in the day, north to Alaska, and obviously
Sing the Bismarck and Johnny Reb and all those.
Yeah, I mean, he had huge, huge songs.
And a heck of a death story, too. Afraid of bridges, yet dies on a bridge.
Really? I didn't even know that.
That was one of the things.
So you're wording me up.
And I'm trying.
I like it.
There's fun stuff. Like, you've always kind of done fun covers over your career. And, you've got the Bee Gees on this. And I don't know how you come up with the covers. If it's just like, hey, it's a good idea. Let's do the Bee Gees. Let's do Alice in Chains.
Well,
it's
a lot less pre-thought than most people would think.
Right.
There's Kehoe down there right now. Picking away on his guitar.
Yeah.
And after this, we'll go down there and plunk away, and we might stumble across something that's interesting. We were working on Holy Diver by Dio a while ago, doing a twang version of it, and we just never completed it.
Yeah.
But the Bee Gees thing, it just, I started twanging away, and then those lyrics popped out of my mouth, and I was like, well, shit, here we go. Let's do this one.
Are you afraid of when it becomes kitsch at some point? Like, okay, we're doing a bluegrass version of the Bee Gees, and it can be looked at as kitsch. Or are you trying to say, like, here's a great pop song, and I want it to be taken seriously at this rootsy, bare-bones version?
No, that's way too much thought.
So it's not anything. It's not so much.
It's pasta being thrown at the walls, and that was a piece that stuck.
Yeah.
And if I worried about what parts of my career are going to be perceived as kitsch, I would have never progressed farther than my first record, because Lord knows the Beaver was taken in many different ways by many different people and undermined
the problem with MTV
undermined certain elements of my sophistication, in theory. Right. But I think you take life with a grain of salt and a little grain of sugar every now and again. It is what it is.
You figured out how to do it. In fact, there is a prime.
I mean, when I get to sit there and play the rough mix of staying alive Twang style in my car for Tom Waits and have him chuckle. That's pretty sweet.
That's a good moment.
That's a pretty sweet position to be in life. So
you've got that. None of us have that. You have that.
Well, there you go.
That's a moment you get to keep. Now, you were talking about longevity. It's something I noticed at the beginning. So there's a Primus book coming out, The Oral History.
Yes.
Which is a great read.
Read it.
I'm about three quarters of the way through it.
The rest of it's boring.
I kind of wonder how it ends. Titanic sink?
The first two thirds is hilarious.
That's what everybody wanted.
That's what happens with bands. Then they get, jaded and boring. And
I don't think that anyone's ever called Primus jaded
and
boring.
All right, well, there you go.
Unless it's the name of the next record,
and Boring. That's not a bad idea.
But you start out, and there's something interesting. And when I saw it, you bring up your grandfather. At the beginning of the book says, my grandpa's still alive. He's 98 years old.
He just passed away.
A
month ago.
Yeah, I'm really sorry.
He's 98. He was ready to go.
Yeah.
I talked to him a few days before he went, and we had some good laughs.
Yeah,
so
that's good.
Yeah.
But I saw that. It's like 98 years old. And here Primus is, against all odds.
98 years
you
old.
You found the key to longevity. And that's what I'm saying. Like, everything was against Primus, it seems like, your story happened, And yet you somehow either muscled through it or just figured out the tricks. I know in the book it talks a lot about you having a plan the entire time and saw it through.
I did.
Did you?
No, hell no. The whole notion, and we were just discussing this a minute ago because I was walking the streets with Kehoe, and I was talking about the first time I was in the studio and this guy recorded this band I was in, and I was a very timid young fellow, and I went up to the guitar player and said, hey, he's playing us the mix, and I'm like, hey, can we turn the bass up a little bit? Can't really hear the bass. And so the guitar player, he was the boss, he's like, how about we turn up the bass a little bit? And the engineer, this British guy, he's like, nope, I refuse to turn up the bass. We're like, okay. And that was the beginning of me going, you know what? Fuck these guys.
Right.
These producers and these bastards that think they know what the hell they're doing. So
you took it in your own hands and actually worked.
I turned up the bass.
It actually
worked. And it worked for me. It made me realize you got to be very careful. You walk a fine line as a young artist. You're very arrogant. And I meet these young artists now, and they're very arrogant, and they're going to take over the world. And that's a great attitude to have, but you have to balance that with sticking to your ideals, but also not being a dick about it.
Right.
So I think we were able to stick to our ideals and not be too terribly dickish about it. Yeah. You know what I mean?
But
that's why we've been able to stick around as long as we have.
And I know a bit of luck plays into that too, because certain things have to fall. A lot of bands, if they try to take control, they're just going to be told no.
There's a little bit of luck, but it's perseverance.
Yeah.
Primus, people say, when you made it. What do you mean when we made it? We started in 84 and just kept trodden up the hill.
I know it was 84. I didn't remember being that early. Yeah.
I mean, the band that everybody knows came together in 88, but it's all about perseverance. Yeah. If you believe in something and you have a vision and you stick to that, it's a harder road, but the foundation you build is much stronger. Mm-hmm. I've had many friends that have been parts of different trends and have shot up and been huge, and now they're long gone, And we've always just kind of cruised along under the radar. We've had our little flashes of mainstream, but for the most part, we're those guys that just sort of do our thing, and there's a lot of people don't give a shit about it, but there's a group of individuals that really do enjoy what comes out of our world.
Well, nothing sounds like you. There's no other
for good or ill. Some people despise that.
Well,
then some people relish it.
There's a lot of lineup changes through the years. I didn't think I'd ever put it together just how many lineup changes. Not a ton, but there were definitely
lineup
changes.
It's mainly drummers.
Yeah.
Because drummer rhymes with bummer. Lonnie Marshall told me that one. And I stick with
that to heart, too.
Yes.
Did Primus ever get to a point, though, where it was just you? Like, Trent Reznor eventually became Nine Inch Nails, and Billy Corgan eventually became Smashing Pumpkins. Because you're a man of collaboration, but I didn't know if Primus was really just... And I'm not trying to take away from the other guys. Amazing musicians,
No. Primus is, there is me, which goes out and does the Frog Brigade, and does the Fungi Brigade, and whatever the hell else. I go do my things, the twang.
Yeah.
And I always say those are the songs that I would never inflict upon the guys in Primus. As a joke. When I first did the Holy Mackerel record, I said that. But a lot of it is just... I have such a strong vision for some of those bits. I don't want to. I'm not gonna tell Tim Herb Alexander, hey, you gotta play this beat that I wrote.
Right.
It's like, what the hell is the point of that?
Yeah.
That being said, this Wonka record, you know, we are kind of cross-pollinizing here. Yeah. We're taking basically my guys, a couple of my guys from my band, and putting them with Primus to do this Wonka record. And I hint about that in the book, that we got this project coming up, and people, some people are not going to be real thrilled, because there are those fans that want the separation between my world and the Primus world. But
it's important.
When all is
you're going to have to get over that.
Well, when all is said and done, I wanted it to be a good project. And I wanted to do the Wonka thing, and I thought about doing it with just my guys and my band. But me and Lur and Tim have been having such a spectacular time playing together. It just, it feels right to do it with these guys. And of course, they knocked it out of the park. You know, I don't know if you've heard it, but the stuff.
I've heard Pure Imagination.
Well, the stuff that Tim plays on this record is phenomenal. And I'm a bit of a drum geek or percussion geek, you know, especially when recording. I'm totally geek out on all this shit. I got all this vintage gear and, you know. And by taking him, who already thinks outside the box, and then putting him on this kit, which is the most bizarre kit you've ever seen. Doesn't even really look like a drum kit. It looks more like just an explosion of percussion and bits. And encircling him in this thing and watching what he does with it, it's really spectacular. I mean, you got one tiny sliver with the Pure Imagination.
I really can't wait to hear it. There's actually a funny part. It's almost like, I don't know if kismet's the right word for this, but Buzz, the Melvins, there's a part in his book where he calls you Willy Wonka.
Oh, really?
He says, you know, Les is Willy Wonka, and I'm just an Oompa Loompa sitting back to listen to them. It's paraphrasing a little bit there, but that's kind of the gist.
Well,
how perfect is that? Because in a way, again, we're talking images here, and here you are tackling one of the greatest, you know, movies for the soundtracks of all time. Something that seems like this was always supposed to happen. You were always supposed to cover Willy Wonka.
Well, and there will be people that will despise it, you know, just like how many people, you know, how people reacted to Tim Burton's version of the Roald Dahl thing, you know. But what the hell? It's a sacred cow that needed to be...
Exactly.
It needed to be bastardized, and we've done it. And it's all in the spirit of, you know, we dedicated the record to Gene Wilder because I've always thought he was an incredible talent, especially the early 70s stuff he did, whether it was Everything You've Always Wanted to Know About Sex and We're Afraid to Ask, a little bit he did in there, Producers, Young Frankenstein. The record is more about my perception of the film as a kid.
Yeah, it was scary. Know?
Yeah.
And Primus made it a little bit more scary.
Well,
I've only heard Pure Imagination.
Well, when you read the Roald Dahl books, they're pretty creepy and sinister.
Right.
You know.
Right. Is there another Primus record after this that you're working on? I should ask that before we wrap this up. Because, again, this is not originals. But you're always working on stuff. I would imagine that there's some kind of plan somewhere down the line of what the next project is going to be.
You know, there's really not. I mean, I'm sure there will be talk once we get into this thing, but right now we're just gearing up. I mean, I'm finishing this Twang thing, and you know, the book's ready to come out, I guess, so it's coming out. We got to gear up for this Wonka thing, make sure the stage production is up to snuff, and we're talking about it's been getting some pretty good buzz already, so we're talking about maybe setting up we're doing some matinees in certain towns for little kids, and just only doing the Wonka thing.
Scaring the shit out of little kids.
Yeah, there you go.
And, since 1986.
And even maybe setting up some residencies here and there to do similar things.
You know what? I just reminded of it. With the Flaming Lips have their Sgt. Pepper tribute coming out.
Well, see, that scared the shit out of me because one of the other projects that I was talking about doing when we went to do this was we weren't going to do Sgt. Pepper. We were going to do Magical Mystery Tour.
So it would have been an interesting, actually. You could still do a joint show if it ever wanted to.
Well, it would have been
one messed up.
It would have been. I'm glad we didn't.
Yeah, right.
You know, I don't want to take any wind out of their sails, and I don't want them taking any wind out of mine.
I think
I very much love the Lips.
Yeah, no, I think you went the right way on this. It caught me by surprise.
Plus, they're already using Miley. I don't know if we would have been able to get her.
You could have Katie.
Who the hell's that?
Katy Perry. You take Katy Perry. They have Miley Cyrus. So.
Then we get Billy Ray. He's got to get his old hairdo back.
Yeah, right. Yeah. One up to me. Les, it's been a pleasure, sir.
Yeah, no worries.
Thank you so much.